very important aspect with regards to the overall assessment, which is basically required from a clinical perspective, which is a bone age assessment. Because unless you understand the bone age and the pubertal assessment, you will not be able to achieve a proper evaluation of a child with growth failure. So you're basically comparing the bones of that particular child with the bones of a ideal child, or let's say a average child. So you're basically comparing between the two and seeing how the child is compared to that. So this gives you an idea that this is the bone. It is similar to a height age. When you say height age, you mean that the child is now having a height of an 8-year-old. So his height age is 8 years. Similarly, if you say weight age is 8 years, you say it's around 8 years. Same is about bone age. So when you're looking at bone age, you are basically comparing the skeletal maturation of a child with other people of a given age. Now, you need to understand that the process of the overall endochondral bone formation is different from membranous ossification. So there are two types of ossification. In membranous ossification, basically, the osteoblast will directly form the bone and it will have an appositional growth. So you have an area in which bone is formed, which keeps on growing. Which parts of the body have a membranous growth, Pratik? So basically, the flat bones, so skull bones, scapula, some part of the long bones also will have a membranous growth. But most long bones will actually have what is known as a endochondral bone formation. So when we talk about endochondral bone formation, there are two types of ossification centers which develop. One is a primary ossification center, which basically develops before birth. So this is an antenatal period. You have the primary ossification center which is formed. On that primary ossification center, you have deposition of collagen and cartilage which is formed. What type of cartilage is there? What type of collagen is there in the cartilage in the chondrocytes? One is for bone, so two is basically for the cartilage growth. So type 2 collagen is being laid. After that, you will have a vascular invasion which will happen within that particular cartilage. And we all know that chondrocytes go through the various phases of growth. They will be resting initially, then they will proliferate, they will hypertrophy, and then they will apoptose or die. And after apoptosis, you will have this vascular invasion which will come. So as soon as the chondrocytes die, they release signals which attract the vascular signals. So like VEGF, the vascular endothelial growth factor will come in and will attract the osteoblast along with the induction of these, basically the blood vessels also will come. And after that, you will have a calcification which happens. So basically the bone will have different parts which we need to understand. So you will have this long bone, which is basically made of a cortical bone. This is known as, the shaft of the bone is known as diaphysis. Then you have got the epiphysis, which is basically on top of the growth plate. So growth plate is the unmineralized section. On top of that, you have epiphysis. On below that, you have metaphysis. So when you talk about bone age assessment, you're basically looking at comparison of the metaphysis and epiphysis. This is what is the most important thing to look at in terms of bone age. So long bones, epiphyseal centers come, and that this basically allows for linear growth. Now, when do the primary ossification centers come in? Pawan, I've just told you. So primary ossification centers come before birth. What about secondary ossification center? When does the first secondary ossification center appear? Pratik.
Tibia.
So lower part of femur and upper part of tibia will be the epiphysis which should have appeared at birth. And if you have somebody who has congenital hypothyroidism, you will not have those epiphyses which would have appeared by that time. So this is an important thing to remember from that perspective. So this is a bone age X-ray that we typically talk about. Now, what are the key precautions that you take in terms of when you're taking a bone age X-ray? First of all, you should take the non-dominant hand. So classically, it has been taken as non-dominant, but because it is not very easy, we don't ask everybody whether you are a right-handed or left-handed. We talk about basically the left-hand and wrist. But if you talk about convention, the convention is non-dominant hand. Why non-dominant hand? So the activity will be less. If your activity is less, your bones will get less signal for mineralization, because we have discussed about, when we talked about bone, is that if your muscles are inactive, the osteocytes don't sense any changes which is happening. And they will then secrete a compound which is known as sclerostin, which basically asks bones to sleep, don't work. If you have activity, that sclerostin production is reduced and bone starts getting formed. So you need to have a standard set when you want to compare. So you are saying non-dominant. So it has been developed in non-dominant because they feel that if it is dominant, the activity level may vary. So somebody who is working a lot will have a greater use of the dominant horn as compared to somebody who is working less. So that is why this non-dominant concept came into picture, but this is the convention. So we say left hand, but it is basically a non-dominant hand. And it has to be a picture which basically involves that there is a wide spread of all the fingers. They should not be narrow. They should be widely spread. And you should be focusing mainly at the level of the carpal when the image is being taken. So it has to be a particular distance specified. If you look at various modules, if you look at the original Tanner Whitehouse studies, or if you look at GP, they have got specific criteria as to what should be the distance between the image, the X-ray beam and the hand, what angle and all those things are there. So hand should be widely spread. And very importantly, the terminal phalanges, which are the most important, should always be visible. Many people send us X-rays in which this is cut. This is not going to give you much information about the bone age in that perspective. Now, when you talk about bone age assessment, there are two components. How much is the maturation and how much is the fusion? So maturation process is basically from proximal to distal. So as you will see that the bones will start appearing as somebody is maturing from proximal to distal. The fusion process is actually the reverse. So it is from the distal to the proximal part that the fusion process basically happens. So if you are talking about somebody who is young, you are looking at proximal bones. While somebody who is nearing fusion, it is the distal bones which becomes important in that situation. So we have different areas which have got different specific aspects. Very importantly, the carpal bones are not very reliable markers as far as bone age assessment is concerned. So you have to focus upon other bones in that situation. Usually, when you talk about growth failure, you're talking about these phalanges. They become more important in that regards. And of course, radius ulna will give you information about terminal fusion. But if you wait for radius and ulna to fuse, things are gone. So if you want to really look at a right time to act, you're looking at these smaller phalanges, not radius and ulna. Girls have an advanced bone age by 1 to 2 years. Why, Narayanan? No, but if they are non-pubertal, some girl is 4 years and boy is 4 years. Still, the girl will have a bone age which is 1 year advanced. Why? Because they have got 3 times more estrogen even during the pre-pubertal age. So even if your estrogen is not detectable by conventional assays, if you look at via the gas chromatography, you will find that the estrogen level in girls are around 2 to 3 times higher than boys. And what we know very clearly is that the most important mediator of epiphyseal fusion is actually estrogen. So that's why girls at all ages will be more mature than boys in that perspective. Now, how do the carpal bones appear and in what sequence? This is something you should need to be very, very important to understand. So the first one to appear is actually the capitate. Now, who will tell me which is capitate out of it? Pratik? So this is the biggest one. So if you see this one, I showed you there were two today in that X-ray. This is the capitate, which is the biggest one, which is the first one to appear. And the appearance basically is around early age group, around 3 months. So now what I'm trying to say is that to tell you, you need to look at historical milestones. When you talk about various civilizations, you say that, okay, carbon dating, this layer was 1000 years, this was 2000 years, this was 3000 years. So you have to fill the gaps. So these are like events. When you talk about bone age maturation, this happened. Like Christ was born, after that this thing happened, you will say then Buddha came in. So all those things are the historical milestones, because these are hard and fast things. Similarly, carpal appearing, capitate appearing is a hard and fast thing. You can't say that, okay, that osteoblast had come at that time because that is not visible. You can only say this is before capitate, after capitate. So the first carpal bone to come up is usually capitate around 3 months of age. Then comes hamate. So hamate is this hammer-like structure, which is, so if you look at the X-ray, these two will always be there because hardly you will see anybody less than 3 months. So most of them will have these two small carpal bones which are coming up there. And this hamate around comes the same time. So capitate and hamate will be the sequence there. From there, you have other bones which will come up. So you have got the triquetral, which is out here. This basically will come late. So now you've got a big gap between 3 months and 2 years. So if you say that somebody has got capitate and hamate, it is more than 3 months, but then it can be anything up to 2 years. So these are not going to help you after that. From 3 months to 2 years, you don't have any carpal bone which will help you decide that this event is going to take place or this event is not going to take place. Now, from there, you've got lunate, which is basically out here. And this all of you should practice and really understand because somebody can just ask you which one is which carpal. And lunate comes quite late. So in a way, it is telling you about which time it is appearing. But then the gap is too big. You say that, okay, I have to go from here to Delhi. The next thing you know, the station is basically Itawa, which is 200 kilometers. And then you don't know anything. You have to go to Delhi. So you would like to have multiple areas. Maybe every 80 kilometers, you know that the station is coming. So you have an idea whether you are reaching Delhi or not. Similarly, if you say, okay, hamate is there, 3 months, trigotal is there, 2 years, then 6 years. So it's not going to help you a lot. You will say 2 to 6 years. The problem with most bone age reports which we get is that they're relying too much about the carpal bones. And that's why this is 6 to 18 years, 6 to 12 years. So all that doesn't make much sense from a clinical perspective. The reason is that the carpals come like that. Plus, they have got huge inter-individual variation. Somebody can have a lunate at 5 years, somebody at 7 years. So it's not a precise way to really predict the bone age if you're looking just at the carpal. The only role may be at the very early stage in the first 1 year whether the capitate hamate are there or not. Now then we've got the scaphoid, which is later appearing around 7 years of age. Trapezium, which appears again around 7 years of age. Then we have got the trapezoid, which comes later. And finally, you've got the pisiform, which basically comes around 11 years. Now, if you want to focus on 3 major carpal bones, I would say focus on capitate hamate, which is easy to identify because they are the first things to appear. So if they are there, they mean that you have at least some bone ages there. And then look at pisiform, because pisiform tells you around 10 years of age. So where is pisiform? It is out there as an additional bone. So if you see on the ulnar side, basically, you will find that there is an additional bone coming in, which means it's around 10 years or more. This is more like a corroborative evidence that you're looking at 10 different things. You're looking at these epiphyses, metaphyses, you're looking at radius and ulna, and then you also see in terms of the carpal bones. Now, if you look at our analysis in terms of bone age, we have not taken any carpal bone in consideration. We give information after 2 years of. So from 2 to 18 years of age, we have not found any of the carpal bones to be of any use. Most people don't find them to be useful in terms of predicting a particular bone age. So why I'm talking this is that if you want to focus on this, just look at capitate, hamate to begin with, and pisiform. So if your pisiform is there, maybe 10 and above is would be the where. And if it is matching with others, you can say, okay, this is a way forward in terms of bone age assessment from that perspective. However, as I've said, there is a significant variation which happens in this, and we need to be cautious about in that regards. What about phalanges? So we have talked about the carpal bones. Now these phalanges, also the epiphyses are going to appear from a proximal to distal fashion. So what you can simply look at is whether you've got this proximal, middle or distal interphalangeal epiphyses which has appeared or not. That is going to give you a picture in terms of the different age. So this is basically what we're looking at. So proximal fillings essentially you've got metacarpal, and then this is the sequence as to how they will start appearing. So as I said, it is proximal to distal, but there is one, this is the difference, proximal fellings will appear first, then you will have metacarpal. So this is the slight variation of the sequence. Then you will have middle fellings, and then finally you will have distal fellings. So now if you have an X-ray in which you've got just the proximal fellings versus one which has got metacarpal, you know that this is older. You have got a middle phalanx, even older. Distal phalanx, even older. So this is another way of rating that. But this is about appearance. This is not about the size or something. So this is going to be valid till the time they appear. So maybe 3 years, 4 years, not beyond that. You can be using in that situation. So distal phalanx will appear. Now there are a few exceptions which you need to remember, that the distal thumb epiphalanx basically tends to appear a bit earlier, around 15 to 18. You can see that, Pratik, which is the distal thumb phalanx. You can see that. So this is an exception. And this you will see in a lot of X-rays, that you will have these small bone around the thumb, but this does not mean that there is a discrepancy. This happens in a normal phenomenon. The other difference which is there is that the fifth middle phalanx may take a long time to appear. So you have to look at all these variations. If you see out here that there is, all the others have got. If you see the thumb has got, the second, third and fourth have got, but there is nothing in the fifth. So thumb and the fifth can have exceptions in the rule. But generally you say proximal, then metacarpal, then middle, then distal. This is how the sequence basically happens in terms of growth. Now phalangeal epiphyseal appearance basically, as I discussed, is of various in form of metacarpal, middle and distal. So you can see here that you have got basically the appearance only of the proximal phalanx, but you have got some metacarpal which is coming in some places. It is not. So this happens typically by 2 years in girls and 3 years in boys. So we'll just talk initially about what time your specific cartilages and all give you information. So around 2 to 3 years of age, you will predominantly have the proximal metaphysis which has come, others have not come. As you go forward, the metacarpals start appearing, that will be somewhere around 4 to 5 years. So 4 years in girls, 5 years in boys. So now your metacarpal is appearing. Subsequent to that, you will have much more epiphysis, and by this time, it is too late. So you're looking at other parameters as well. But if all of these have appeared, your figures will go somewhere around 6 to 7 years of age. So appearance of phalanges will give you a rough idea about how things are going. So as I said, you look at carpal bones, you say capitate hamate present more than 3 years. If you have the next carpal coming, it's around 2 years. If around the same time, here you have seen only capitate hamate, if you look at this. This is very clearly visible. And now your proximal is coming. So now the next set of the carpals have not come, but the proximal have come. So this is somewhere around maybe 2 years. That's what it's looking like. And here, of course, the other parameters will also become important, and the difference between the metaphysis and the epiphysis will become significant, which we have discussed subsequently. Now, if you go from there about phalangeal maturation, this is the most important thing to look at in the bone ages from around 3 to 4 years of age till around 10 to 12 years of age. And this is the time when you want to really look at bone age. You're not bothered about bone age in 2-year-old. You're bothered after 3 to 4 years. So as I said, till 2 to 3 years of age, maybe this has come, this has not come, will become relevant. But after that, you want to really be more precise as to what exactly is the bone. So this is the most important parameter which you have to look at. And out of 5 bone age sites that we found to be the most effective, 3 of them are actually these. 2 are radius and ulna. So these become very, very important. So what you look at it, this structure is the epiphysis, then there is physis or growth plate, and then you have got the metaphysis. So you have to just compare the epiphysis to the metaphysis, and that will give you the picture about that. So this is a time when your epiphysis is much smaller as compared to the metaphysis. So this is basically definitely around, it will appear only around 3 to 4 years of age, so it's around 4 to 8, I would say, as far as boys are concerned. As age progresses, now it has become as big as the metaphysis. And why I'm showing this again is that now we have automated measures as well, But you need to understand what you're looking at. What you want when you're comparing the X-ray which is there in the application and the X-ray you're seeing, you need to know what you want to compare without that. So basically now it's become as big. So this is like 7 to 9 in girls, 9 to 11 in boys. Now it's becoming bigger. You are touching around 10 to 12 years in girls, around 11 to 13 years in boys. Once it starts capping, so when you say capping, now your epiphysis is big, it has gone like this and starts capping. It becomes, so if you put it the other way around, you will see that this is like a cap. This is the down and then your epiphyses are capping around that time. And this basically is around 12 to 14 years. So if your capping is happening, you've got limited time to grow. This is a big message. So if you see this sort of a X-ray, you have to be bothered about it. Now, there are, of course, variations in whether you look at proximal, middle, or distal interphalangeal. All those things are significant. So try to focus on one particular site if you want to look at it. And we, of course, are talking about three different sites that we have selected. But if you want to look at one, the distal phalanges of the middle finger would be the good. The DP3 will be a good site to look at. And that will be one which you can assess in terms of the assessment from that perspective. Now, what about fusion pattern? As the age grows, you will have fusion in a different pattern. So we said appearance was proximal, metacarpal, middle, and distal. Fusion is actually starting from metacarpal, proximal, middle, and that way it goes. So this happens, this fusion will be around after 12 years. If your these bones are fusing 12 years and more in girls. And if the fusion is continuing, 13, and once it's nearly fused, 14 in girls and around 15, 16 in boys. And here you can see there is a hardly any difference in that situation. So this is around 16 to 15 years. What do you think is the final height age as far as the bone age in girl is concerned? 14 and 16 roughly. 99% of growth will be complete by around 14 years in girls and around 16 years in boys. This is pretty much the age you are bothered about in that situation. Now, the next thing, so we discussed about the carpal and the metacarpal. We can discuss about the carpal, the metacarpal and all those. Now, the long bones. Long bones are relevant pretty much in terms of final height perspective, whether you've got time or not. So, for that, the long bone appearance that you can look at is basically radius and ulna. And we know that ulna starts appearing at what time? Narayan. After 5. So before 5, generally ulna will not be there. So you will have just radius to begin with in the initial phase. And this would basically be very early. So this is after your capitate and hamate, you will have the radius to come. So if you have got just the two carpal bones and no radius, it's less than 10. If radius has come in, it's around 10 to 12 months. This is a simple way to understand. From there, you have got start of ulna, which is appearing. And now you look at the other bones are also there quite a lot. So this starts by around 5 to 6 years, 5 years in girls and 6 in boys. Of course, there's a 1 year difference. And then you have to look at the ulna very carefully. I find ulna very, very informative as compared to the other bones. Now, if you look at our the application and how those progress, they are annually. So what we did initially was try to do X-rays 6 monthly and then annually. When we compared, we found that the results were better annually. Probably because 6 monthly, the differences were not significant and people got more confused. So that's why those images are annual images. So if you select one, this will be representative, let's say 8.3, then another will be 9.3. So it will be annualized images rather than a 6 monthly image. What you're looking at, if you talk about ulna, is that if you compare this ulna from this ulna, what are the major differences you see? So the earlier one was having just a simple, like a small, and it would look like a carpal bone. This one has got a different shape which is coming. So the first, now the one which is in between is not there, and maybe I'll show you through the app again once. If you see here, that you will have a ulna which is just like a small triangle. You will not have any depression. This ulna has got a process which is now starting. So there is a compression here, and then you've got this extra horn, the styloid process, which is basically coming up here. This means that it is really now getting advanced in that perspective around above 10 years. So if you look at this X-ray, you've got pisiform. Which is pisiform? This white one. So there's one bone. On top of that, there's another bone. This is pisiform. That is there. Ulna is curved more than 10 years. You can just finish. If you look at other things as well, a lot of carpals have really appeared. They look matured. Like a lot of people talk about the hook of the hamate, how the capitate is looking at. Tanner Whitehouse is all about that. They talk about 13 sites. And a lot of these sites about each and every carpal bone shape, size. But then if your X-ray is tilted, if your exposure is different, that causes more confusion. So therefore, when we did with the original 13-site Tanner, we found that these did not add at all to the overall result. So they did not have a better outcome in that perspective. So these are important, but they are variable, difficult to judge, and they will lead to inter-individual variability. These are very simple. You're looking at just these bones and radius and ulna. That's it. That is why you've got good reproducibility with that. So now if you look at it, this ulna is basically telling you it's about 10 years of age. If you go further, what you're seeing is that this process is now, there was this simple triangle, then this small edge is coming. Now this becomes like a proper steroid process. If you see here, this is very clearly visible. So this will basically be somewhere around 12 years, something like that happening. So just subtle. And this is how, if you see too many X-rays, you will start realizing, even going without going to the atlases or the application, that you will understand what you're talking about. Now, long bone fusion patterns, of course, as time goes, now you can see ulna is fusing earlier. While radius, there is a gap. So generally, radius tends to have a later fusion, but then you don't have much time to grow in that situation. So this happens by around 14, 15 years would be the time. With time, your radius is also fusing. So by this time, I would say no, nothing, no treatment should be given here, even though the radius is showing slight this thing. Now, if you look at radius also, there is a change which happens in radius. And what I would like to highlight is the white line. Are you seeing the white line? So within the radius, there is a white density. And this density becomes denser with age. So this line goes like this and comes back like this. So if you see out here, you will basically see that there is a, this bone, this density is coming here. If it is becoming more dense, it is more likely to be closer to fusion in that situation that you will encounter. And of course, with time, it will fuse by that time. This is not a reliable marker of deciding our growth potential, because it may be too late if you wait for the radius and ulna to fuse. You're looking at mainly these distal bones, which will give you a better picture in that. So now if you look at it in summary, for very small kids, less than 1 year, look at just three things: capitate, hamate, and radius. That's it. After that, 2 to 2.5 years, look at these small bones, whether the proximal ones have started appearing or not, whether you have got the the lunate and all the other ones who have started appearing in terms of the pattern for the carpals, basically, in that regard. So these are looking at, once you go beyond 4 years, focus mainly on the comparison between the epiphyses and the metaphyses. Around 10 years, also have a look on the ulna. How is it looking like? Whether it is tilting, curving, steroid process, and all those things. So, pisiform, there are not. So multiple factors will start coming into the picture. Now, where should you do that? So the ideal one for the neonatal period, you want to do it mainly for the setting of, let's say, congenital hypothyroidism, is at the level of the knee. Then, if you talk about most other ages, it is actually the non-dominant hand and wrist. Shoulders, we don't do it, but a lot of people do it mainly for more of medico-legal purposes, not much of a benefit from that situation. Now, precautions are discussed. Complete hand is essential. They should be spread out, and exposure should be appropriate. If it's not well exposed, you will get a white or that sort of a film, which will not be a reliable one. Now, methods which are there, which are available, are the GP Atlas, the Tanner Whitehouse Atlas, and you have got the automated bone expert, which are available. Now, the basic difference in the concept of a GP Atlas versus Tanner Whitehouse is that GP Atlas is a holistic picture. So you are looking at a person and then you're trying to basically try to compare that to another person. Tanner Whitehouse is dividing that image into different parts and giving different ratings and then combining. So both have got an advantage and a disadvantage. The problem with GP Atlas is that suppose you want to compare one hand to the other, it will not happen that everybody will follow the same rules. Somewhere you will find that there is a discrepancy in the radial growth as compared to the discrepancy in the metacarpal growth. Some will have some maturity mode, so you can't have a perfect fit. So you've got x-rays every 6 months, which you compare to the x-ray, and you may or may not find it, but you will get something in between. So this is it. While in Tanner Whitehouse, you have got initially 20 and then 13 sites, which you have to compare. It is easier to compare a site to site as compared to a whole hand. That is why we decided to stick to the Tanner Whitehouse pattern in terms of getting the results out, because it's easier to compare sites from that perspective. Now, automated expert, the bone expert which we use, is basically looking at the size, the shape, the density of each bones, and then it gives a score. Based upon that score, you get the result out from that situation. So Grulich Pile Atlas is basically the one which is the oldest atlas which has been used overall in that regards, and it compares different. So you will say this is 11 and you compare this, you find it's close to 11 or 10, and you will say this is the age basically, as far as this is the most common, developed on Caucasian children, comparison with a radiograph is done. Tanner Whitehouse is basically based upon these sort of images. So you've got basically comparing different sites, and then you give the different scoring systems, and based on that you do a final score which is combined, which gives you a final idea on that. Applications are also available for Tanner Whitehouse, in which you compare that. It looks 20 sites initially, scoring of individual bones, and then combined total assessment is done from that regards. And of course, you've got the automated bone age estimation, which is the bone expert, which basically gives you result both as compared to the. So what they've done is that they have developed, first of all, standards put on the computer that this, if it looks like this is the score, if it looks like this is the score, you do a complete score. Then you do a regression analysis as compared to the Tanner Whitehouse and as compared to the GP. So based upon those scores, they give two different results. So if you look at our results, they will give you GP and Tanner Whitehouse. This is based upon different equations. So it's not that the same fellow will have two different ages. What they've tried to do is that suppose you had done it by a Tanner Whitehouse, it would have come like 9.6. If you look at in terms of the GP method, it will be like 10. So what do you think is the difference that they give in terms of reports? Which one seems to be older as compared to the other?
The GP is older.
The GP, usually they tend to overestimate the bone age. And what they're trying to say is that you should ideally, if you talk about an individual perspective, follow the GP rather than the Tanner Whitehouse in their own interpretation. That's what they are saying. And they provide standard deviation score also. So it's very easy. If you know the mean, you will get the SDS from there. So this is the bone age report. And this is what Prateek was saying. Basically, what you see is that the Tanner Whitehouse is around 3 to 6 months behind as compared to the GP. And this is what you will see. Here it is. It's mentioned 7.05 and 6.83. Now, when they say bone age standard deviation score, so that is compared to a particular population. So they've got Caucasian standard, which they're giving. And this way, they will give you the result in that situation. Now, we need to understand from a clinical perspective which site to look at different ages. So which we already discussed. In the initial phase, first 10 months, basically, you're looking at capitate hands. As they go bigger, you are starting to look at the smaller epiphyses, how many have appeared. And that will give you an idea. Then from there, the major thing is the comparison of the epiphyses to metaphyses. If it's smaller, less than 4, slightly smaller, 4 to 8, equal 8 to 10, more 10 to 12, capping more than 12. Roughly, that will be the ways. And then every bone will give you an average. So this is how it will work. And then, of course, with older, you go ahead with the fusion of the phalanges. And even older, you will look at the long bone, how the radius and ulna has fused. So this is how you will look into the individual bones. So we'll go through a few examples. So this is the infant. You're mainly looking at the carpal bones. So what you're seeing here, Pawan? capped hamate is there, so above 3 months. You're also seeing smaller epiphyses have also started appearing. So it's actually there in the metacarpal, in the proximal, middle and distal. So all are there. So it's a slightly older from that perspective. As you see here also, you have got the capitate and hamate are there, but you also have got these epiphyses which have appeared till the middle one. You don't have the distal one. So again, this will tell you this is around Pratik. More than 1 year, maybe around 2 to 2.5 years would be the more likely cause. Now, as you go by the size of epiphysis, you compare the epiphysis as compared to the metaphysis, you see the one on the left-hand side is much, much smaller. And as you go toward the right side, it tends to increase over time. And the same happens around mid-puberty, you're talking about 8 to 12. This will become as big as the metaphysis, and the right-hand side is slightly bigger. Also, if you can see, and as time goes further, it starts capping and then finally starts fusing. So this gives you a good idea. And if you compare different bones, you will see, okay, this one is nearly capping. This one is basically closed, smaller, and then you can get a rough idea based upon that. Bone expert basically will give you the result and then you can use it to predict the final height. There are various ways of prediction of final height. There is a Bailey-Pinau method, which is based upon the Grulich Pile Atlas, there is one from the Tanner White House, and also one from the Bone Expert, which is there in terms of that. So Bailey-Pinau table, Tanner method, and extrapolation from the chart also will help you make this. So we'll now get into a couple of x-rays. 7-year-old boy with short stature. What do you see out here? Bone age, Pawan. What all are you seeing? Which all carpals? And there is one more. Yeah, so it's around 2 to 2.5 anyway. It goes beyond that. What about ulna? Not there. Radius? Radius is there. So it's definitely above that. Of course, it's more than 10 months. You've got all the various bones. Also, the smaller bones have started appearing in the middle, the proximal, below the distal. So all of them started appearing. So it is basically, if you look at epiphysis, it is definitely small epiphysis appeared even at the distal part. Carpal bones, 3 carpal bones have appeared. Long bone, the radius has appeared. So this is what, if you don't have access to the app, you can look at, try to divide it into these 3. But again, it becomes difficult. And then you will get the bone age around 3.5 years roughly. This is in a way to go ahead. 13-year-old boy with tall, short stature and delayed puberty. What do you see, Pratik? Yeah, in many bones they are larger than that. Carpal bones, what you are seeing? All of them are there. Pisiform is the most important. You can see the pisiform at the lower part of it. It is there. The long bone, if you look at it, the ulna has got that curve which has started to appear, but it's not the steloid process yet. The white line in the radius is not very prominent. And the radius is looking a bit smaller. So it's not like a total near fusion state. It's definitely less than 13 years in this stage. So you will keep it at?
11
years. Yeah. Pawan? More than 10 definitely. And I would say not more than 12. So it's around 10 to 12 or 11 would be the most likely situation in that setting. So 11 was a precise one in that condition. 7-year-old girl with early puberty. Narayanan, what do you see? Epiphysis is? So epiphysis is slightly bigger as compared to the metaphysis. Carpals, all there.
Even the
pisiform, it's there.
It has come up there.
So you can see that extra double bone is there, that pisiform is there. If you look at this x-ray, it is even clearer. This is just the zoomed x-ray, that's why it's looking a bit confusing. Long bones, you've got that steloid process also coming up. Radius, so it's actually maybe more or around the same as that boy. So it is around 11.5 years we are giving. If it was a boy, it would have been more. This is a girl, so that's why we're giving an underrated figure. For a boy, we would have said it is around 12.5, 13. So it's more than that boy, but definitely much more advanced. See, if you know it's more than 9 years, you're okay. 7 years is the chronological age. If it's more than 2 years, then the chronological age, it is significant. So this is hugely significant.
So it took time. There were comparative things. So we wanted to develop a simplified tool, validate that, and compare with the standard. So on that, there was a very good work which was done by Riddhi, and she will be sharing about how we have developed a very simplified way of doing bone age in that regard, sir.
What was the aim of development of our mobile application? That we were able to develop the simple and accessible tool which is validated against the gold standard method of 10 White House 3, which is comparable with the currently available method of Bone Expert, and most importantly, the non-expert user, the pediatrician, which are not using routinely Bone Age in their practice, they were able to do it easily. So our method was developed from 307 radiographs by 3 expert users, and based on age and gender analysis, 13 different sites, which is recommended by 10 White House 3, were initially selected, and then they from those 13 sites, top 5 sites were selected based on regression analysis from the validation of these sites from 200 radiographs. After that, these sites were loaded on mobile platform and then validated with the 10 White House 3 method by 2 expert users in 250 radiographs. And the precision and accuracy of our method was calculated using the various statistical parameters. We also calculated the precision and accuracy and time of assessment of the bone age from both mobile application as well as 10 White method by both expert and non-expert users. So here, user is to just look with the morphological feature of the only 5 sites, that includes the middle phalanx of middle finger, proximal phalanx of middle finger, proximal phalangeal epiphysis of thumb, ulnar and radial epiphysis. So what user has to see is the everyone has to select the size, shape, and whether white line is visible on the epiphysis or not, whether capping has been started or not, or whether fusion has been started or not. So it is very easy. You have to just select these parameters, and you have to keep this in your mind and select with the best match parameter in our mobile app. You don't have to remember the site of the name of the site. You have to just select the bone age of our mobile application, where press the gender, select age of date of the birth, and then select the best morphological match of this site. Like in this X-ray, the middle epiphysis of the middle phalanx is close match with this site. Then press on this. Then proximal phalanx of middle finger. Then also select, also look for the white line. Like in thumb, both the white line are visible, and the epiphysis is slightly longer than metaphysis. After that, ulna and radial epiphysis. So after selecting only these 5 sites, you will get the bone age and also the range of the bone age. So we have also compared our mobile application-based bone age assessment with gold standard method of 10 White House 3 from 250 radiographs, and we found that there is similar intra-individual and inter-individual variability like 10 White House 3 method. So it has similar accuracy and precision like 10 White House 3 method. And in comparison with Bone Expert, our mobile application has better accuracy because it has lower root mean square error and lower relative standardized difference as compared to Bone Expert. So it is more accurate as compared to Bone Expert. And even among non-expert users, the difference between mobile application and 10 White House 3 method is only 5 months. That is negligible difference, and that is comparable with Bone Experts. So accuracy among non-expert user is lower, but it is in acceptable range. And we have been also able to reduce the time of assessment of bone age, that is around 50% for both expert and non-expert user. That was significant reduction. So we can easily do bone age assessment in our routine practice. So we have been able to develop the a mobile application which is simple and accessible, which is validated against the gold standard, and which is superior to non-expert, and even any pediatrician or non-expert user can do it in their routine practice.
What you do in that regard is that you've got this particular X-ray, and what you need to do is to really compare that particular site with a specific site. So there are five preloaded sites, as Riddhi has said. All you have to do is to compare each site. So there, this is the first one. The middle finger, you have to compare with the most suited X-ray in that regard. So when you compare that, you select that particular button. The next thing you do is to compare the next site. And again, you have to look which is the closest to that particular site. The key things to look at is overall the shape, how they are looking, and how they are comparing to the epiphysis. So there are five regions which you have to basically compare. We have got two from the middle phalanx. We have got one from the thumb, one from radius, and one from ulna. So these are five. The rough time which is taken, as Riddhi said, is around 2 minutes would basically be there for a non-expert user who has not used that. And this has been very well validated. So this is the third side thumb. You have to just compare the thumb for that, and you will be able to find on that. So you just have to look at the X-ray closely and compare to the different sites. You will get that. So again, radius, you have to compare in that situation. You will compare, and you will find that there are multiple images which are available, which you can compare and then decide from that situation. And finally, for ulna, you compare in that situation. So based once you've done that, you will get a precise estimate of bone age, and as Riddhi said, it is very close to the standard methods, and you will get a specific answer.